Children need to see their feelings, particularly the darkest ones, reflected in their stories. Mitigating the darkness of the fairy tale takes away their power to reassure children that they are not alone in their fearful imaginings, that they are shared and can be addressed. So it's a lot more scary. Kids are going to have nightmares whether you let them watch the scary movie or not. They're going to have nightmares whether they hear the scary story or not. And if they're having those nightmares but not finding anything that matches that fear in real life, especially in their stories in a controlled environment, like J.K. Rowling says, where they can learn to deal with fear, then it's going to be that much more frightening. A couple of months ago, before I ever read Where the Wild Things Are to Sophie, she started crying in the middle of the night, and I went in and I calmed her down and made sure she went back to sleep, and she was asleep again. The next morning, I woke up and I walked in, and she looked right at me and said, "Daddy, last night we were at the store and the circle came and took me from you." She had had a nightmare about us being doing, we always do the grocery shopping together, and some random shape came out of nowhere and stole her. She's already having nightmares. So let's start learning to handle fear. You know, and so we've been reading Where the Wild Things Are, and we get to the terrible claws. We get to the terrible claws, and every time that we get to that point, she goes, "And I don't like those terrible claws." And then we just move right on to the Wild Grumpus, and we have a blast. It's really great. So we're going to be kind of returning to that, as well as a great scene in Harry Potter that depicts that very thing. We'll get to there. Two more things about Gothic literature in general, and then we're going to start going book by book a little bit here. Gothic literature is often more popular during, and if you heard the recent Pottercast, the Potter Pundits segment, you heard about this, it's during times of social upheaval, where there's a lot of protests going on, where there's people who are unsettled with the way the world is, where they're afraid of what's going on in the world, and that kind of thing, Gothic literature tends to be more popular because we're entering into a world where we can start feeling those fears and dealing with them where we may not be willing to face them in our daily lives. And so Gothic literature becomes popular then. And finally, and I think this is the most important thing about Gothic literature, and there are so many things I'm missing, but we just don't have time to talk about them tonight. The most important thing about Gothic literature is that it depicts dehumanization. Humans being less than they could or should be. And so you've got Frankenstein's monster, who is something of a picture of what Frankenstein himself could potentially be. You've got Dracula, who is alive, but he's dead. And he's really dead, and he is dehumanized, but still in human form. The Horcruxes, we'll talk about, is a picture of dehumanization, because every act Voldemort makes to split his soul, he becomes less human, and less human, and less human, and begins looking like a snake. And so, Tolkien said, all good stories are about the fall. Now, he was, being a Roman Catholic, was talking about the Judeo-Christian version of the fall, and probably not everybody in this room believes that, but I think everybody in the room believes there's something not right with the world right now. There's something going funky. Otherwise, we wouldn't all be voting for the candidate of change, right? I mean, we believe we want change because we need something needs to be changed. And if you didn't vote for that guy, well, now you think there should be change. just so that we can be inclusive of all political points of view. So we're going to go, those are the main themes. We're going to go now through a kind of a jet tour, book by book, of the Gothic elements in each book and hopefully see some of this playing out. Philosopher's Stone. I call it Philosopher's Stone. You're all Americans, and I think you can deal with it.
Thank you.
Opening. Claustrophobic space. Harry is in a cupboard, probably no bigger than that bathroom. And it's frightening, kind of. You know, he comes out of this space, and if you read Neil Gaiman, Coraline, she crawls through that space and then comes out of it, and there's her other mother, and it's all very scary. Well, the Dursleys were kind of like that for Harry. It's better to be in the claustrophobic space almost, because when he comes out, it's the Dursleys, and that's frightening. So we've got obvious claustrophobic spaces for Harry in the first book. We've got the supernatural beginning to invade the natural. So it starts with these weird parties going on, people in cloaks, and Vernon's really upset. And then you've got the stories of Harry's hair growing back, and the boa constrictor being set on Dudley, and then of course the letters start coming. This is terribly frightening, and then Hagrid shows up, and so the supernatural begins to invade the natural world in a way that is frightening to a lot of people. John Grigio said in the last Potter Pundits, it's like a scene out of The Birds, the Hedgehog movie, also there's owls everywhere. So we've got that. We've definitely got mysteries, because here's Harry, the poor boy under the cupboard, who turns out to be nothing like he thought he was. And who is he really? And what really happened to his parents? And why is everyone so afraid of this he who must not be named guy? What's the deal? And he's not getting the whole picture. And then, of course, where's the stone? Or what is the package? It turned out to be the stone. What is this package? So there's another mystery. And who killed the unicorns? There's another mystery, which ends up leading to a big... The Gothic heights of this story, the two big Gothic heights of this story, are Harry in the forest.
Yeah.
He's walking along, finds the cloaked figure, stands up, blood is dribbling, silver blood is dribbling down his cloak. I mean, the series gets darker. It started pretty dark. And Harry, you know, Harry's just frozen, and he's pulled away by Frenzy, and Harry doesn't know what's going on, and it's all a big mystery. And there's the explanation that anyone who drinks... unicorn blood now lives a cursed life. Well, there's a picture of dehumanization. You become less human because you are killing what is innocent to keep yourself alive, which is Voldemort's theme from start to finish. And then, of course, at the end, you've got the man with two faces. There's a hat on the back of his head. There's a face on the back of his head. That's freaky, especially for an 11-year-old kid. And then you've got Dumbledore, who's just sort of playing this whole thing. Yeah, I'll let Harry go face the man with two faces. See, Dumbledore knows kids need to experience some fear, right? and then, of course, the great Gothic figure of the series, Severus Snape, is introduced. And, boy, I could spend all night talking about him, and if I start, I won't stop. So you know Snape is a Gothic figure. And read my chapter when you buy my book on Severus Snape. I mean, he is down in the dungeon, playing with potions. He is your typical Gothic scientist, like Frankenstein, meddling with stuff he shouldn't, making his own spells. Here he gets the book in Half-Blood Prince, and there's new stuff in there that cuts people right open, and Harry decides, why don't I try this and see what it does? It's really dumb. So Snape is something of a Victor Frankenstein. And so there's a kind of a quick jet tour through Philosopher's Stone, and on to Chamber of Secrets we go, which is Gothic start to finish. You've got kind of cliches throughout this book. The death day party. Aha, you know. I mean, that whole thing's like, poor Nick, you know. We're all going poor Nick, but we're also going ha-ha, you know. We're kind of mean to Nick. Nick's head is almost off, the poor guy. So you've got kind of the funny stuff. You've got Myrtle, you know, is kind of amusing, kind of annoying, especially in the fourth movie. Is kind of just obnoxious. And so you've got the cliches, but then you've got whispers in the walls. And then you've got bloodstains on the walls. And you've got some secret room that no one can find. And there's a monster in there, and it was sealed off years ago because somebody died because of it. And who is Harry, by the way? He's struggling again with identity. There's a mystery. Am I Slytherin's heir? Am I doing things I don't know I'm doing? And even worse, am I doing evil things that I don't know I'm doing? And so there's some dehumanization. Is Harry being robbed of his choice? Because when you're robbed of your choice, if you're robbed of your freedom to choose, then you have lost some of your ability to be human, to make choices. So you've got those sorts of things going on, and that, especially this whole theme of what is in Harry's blood and will he be able to escape it, is a frightening thing in Gothic literature. Is he going, if he is Slytherin's heir, and we find out later that to an extent he is he going to be able to escape that fate, or is he going to lose all choice? And this happens in some of Lovecraft's really great stories where the protagonist finds this group of dehumanized individuals and they're just awful and disgusting. He runs from them in horror and he's afraid, and then against his own choice he becomes just like them. Read some Lovecraft, great stuff. Shadow over Innsmouth is a really great one for those themes. There's another fun thing going on in Chamber of Secrets. I want to read something to you. Let's see. Let me see if I'm getting the right book here. Yes. Okay. This is a description of... I approach this tentatively because I get some criticism for this point of view. And that's fine. Wrong quote! Where's the right one? Do I have the right one? I may not have the right one. Big pause. Well, maybe I don't. And that's going to make this more difficult. Talk amongst yourselves. Everyone at home, you've got a moment to go to Amazon.com. Here it is! I got it. Okay, this is a description.